which is anyway available in the built-in library. So why do it here? As an example, I give it to you. Now take this example. Here what is being done? We take a variable called offset. We assign it to a value of 0. Then we do the same processing. Obviously, we'll get the same result, right? Plus offset 0. So now the question is this functional program? Right? Why not? Somebody said no.
Yeah, because we are passing the offset here. Instead of, we have to do manipulation of the offset inside a function which we will be passing here.
But we are not manipulating offset, we are only using it.
It's not pure, the lambda is not pure.
So how will you define pure?
It depends on state that is outside its
scope. Correct. So this is the most important concept of functional programming. You forget about first class functions, higher order functions, partial functions, closure. Even if you don't know anything, somebody asks you what is functional programming, this is the answer you have to give. Functional programming takes inputs and its output is determined solely by its inputs. So now offset is not actually an input to the lambda expression. It is coming through some other way. The reason it is coming, the reason map function is able to, lambda is able to use it, is because in Python, any expression here can use variables from the surrounding scope. This was introduced in version 2.2 in 2001. That means although offset is in an outside scope, the lambda expression can use it. But this goes against the principle of functional programming. Because functional programming should act only on the input. In our case, the input is this, the words coming out of hello. So the result should be determined only by hello, not by anything else. So because you are using offset from externally, this breaks functional programming. So if you write code like this, it is perfectly valid in Python. In fact, people will do this. But if somebody tells you this is functional programming, that is wrong. It is not functional programming.
Even map and list also not functional programming? Okay,
pardon?
Lambda is okay, but map and list also not.
See,
not
if I remove this offset, it becomes functional. As he said, pure. That means result is determined solely by the inputs. Now it is considered functional programming because you are not dependent on anything outside the inputs.
Yeah, that is still that lambda function.
That is okay.
My question is about
this
map and list also not functional programming?
Map, yeah, if you look at the standard, the way map is implemented, it depends only on its inputs.
Okay, so
same
that means it is functional
this,
programming, right? So map and lambda, because it acts like inline in C++, so it is like another comment, like lambda it acts like an inline function in C++.
Inline function, yeah.
So that's why we cannot treat that as a function.
No, not generally. In this example, it is functional because I removed the offset.
Okay.
So now output is determined only by the inputs, which are the words from the hello string. But if I go back and, you know, put the offset back, right, then it becomes a non-functional. Right? So that is what that gentleman said. He used a term called state. Right? In all imperative languages like C and C++ or object-oriented languages, state is determined by the value you assign to variables. So this is a variable and you are assigning a certain value to it. So now that is the state of the program. Right? But in functional programming, state is irrelevant. In fact, they try to do stateless programming, which makes sense because if everything is determined by the input, you don't need states. So functional programming in some sense is the opposite of object-oriented programming. But there are languages which combine both. Scala, for example, it combines a mix of both Java and functional programming. So we understood that. Generally, functional programming are very strong in processing lists of items, lists of integers, strings, whatever, different types. So some of the, like here, I have a simple example. In Python already we have two functions, all and any. So very neat functions. So you can consider them as functional programming functions. So everyone understands all and any. So for example, in this case, if I make this one, all of them are true, so the result is true. Right? If any of them are true, then the any result is also true. So that's how it works. Now in the earlier example, I gave a very trivial example, lambda, I put length of x, but as I said, a built-in function is already there, why would you do that? So let's say you want a more complex example, something like this. I want to count the number of bubbles. each of the words. Then I do a lambda expression like this. So I use regular expression, I find all the vowels, and then I put a length on that. So this is what I get. This is the number of vowels in each of the words in that string. Okay. So now I want to sum up all the vowels. Right. So then Python already has a built-in function for that called sum. So this is what I do. Yes. So remember, these are all trivial examples. I'm using this example to show the functional programming stuff. So now the same thing can be done by a function called reduce. Some of you might have heard the term reduce in the context of what? Big data, right? MapReduce. So MapReduce, the idea comes from here. Map function we have already seen. This is the reduce function. In Python 2, reduce was part of the built-in functions. In Python 3, they have removed it. Actually, they moved it inside functional tools package. So the way to do this, the same problem is like this. You pass the sequence, in this case, the count of the vowels. And you say, I want to add them. So the operator we are going to use is add. And I start with the initial value of 0. So then it keeps adding each element, and then it gets to 15. Same answer. So you can use reduce to do the same thing. The other one is accumulate. This is another function. This doesn't come from, see, earlier we used func tools. Now we are going to use another one called iter tools, which is a set of tools, set of methods that help you to manage iterators. So in that there is a function called accumulate. So what you do here is, let's run it first. Of course, same answer. So what accumulate does is, it calculates partial sums. Anyone knows partial sums? It's a mathematical concept. So it's easy to understand if I remove this index. So this is my list of vowels, 2, 2, 1, right? Now you see, this is the first partial sum, this is the second partial sum, this is the third partial sum. You get it? This is the sum of all the elements preceding. So now what we want is the last partial sum, this one. So this is what you do, you get that. So this is the alternative of using reduce, by using the concept of partial sums. Now this is again a very trivial example. A more useful case of using partial sums is something like this. Suppose you have a convergent series and you want to find out where exactly it converges, at what point it converges. Then you can make use of accumulate. So if you take only one term, you get one. Then you see, slowly starts converge. After 10 terms, it has converged fairly well. So here, a function like accumulate is very useful because you can find out how many terms are required for the function to converge. Okay, next concept in functional programming is data flow is more important than statements and assignments. We already touched upon this. We said that we want stateless programming in functional programming. We don't want to maintain states, which means that people are those who are beginners to functional programming. In normal languages, you compute something and you assign it to a variable, right? In functional programming, we want to avoid that. Then people start scratching their head. Okay, you never do assignments. Then what is the point of computing in the first place? So in functional programming, the data flow is more important. The last result, you can print it out. No point maintaining intermediate results. Okay. So suppose you have to perform a sequence of steps. You do all of them in a pipeline. Only the last one you write to a file or a database or do a printing. So that is what is important to you. So here we have a couple of examples. So you see this map function again, taking the length of all the words. But we want to filter it again. So first we count the number of words, then we filter it. Why we filter? We want to retain only those words which are greater than 2. Okay, that means longer than 2 characters. Okay, so let's run this. So okay, we got some output, but this is not what we want. We want the words, not the count. So how do you do it? So you do it like this. So in the map function, instead of just calculating length, you return both length as well as the word as a tuple. And having done that, then you put it through another filter. So now you see I filtered it already. So I have a chain of commands now. I have map and then I filter. Here, what do I do? This is still not solving our problem. Our problem is we want only the words, we don't want the count. Are you with me? We want words longer than two characters, but we don't want the count, we want to discard the count. So you again put it through another map function. So you get the idea, this is functional programming. You don't store the intermediate results. You process something, put it through another level of processing. Process again, put it through another. So here we have three levels, first map, then filter, again a map. So first map counts, gets the length, second map does the filter, second function does the filtering, third one again transforms it. Get only the words. So now it turns out that it's easier to do with a third party library called Tools. So you may want to check it out. T-O-O-L-Z. So this is written for functional programming purpose. So here what you do? Here there's a function, nice function called pluck. So if you do pluck, straight away you'll get the words. So what happens is, instead of doing this extra map here, suppose you have an output like this. Right, a list of tuples, and the tuple has two elements. You want to pluck only the second elements of the tuple. So that can be done with pluck. Are you with me? So in many, even if you are not, enthusiastic about functional programming, this is a function you can use. A lot of times you may have a list of tuples, and you want to pluck only the second element. Right? Easy, you can do it with this, this stuff. So, yeah, so this is what it is. See, there's an extra zero here. So typically a pluck of one will return you this a list of tuples. But if you want to discard the tuple type, only want the strings, then you can use that extra zero. That means you retrieve the element of the tuple. So this is what you get. Now coming back to our same problem. It took us so many steps, right? Map, filter, map. And instead of the last map, you can do pluck. Python simplifies all this. You can do all of that in just one statement, which is our comprehension. Right? You don't have to do all that business of map, filter, math, and then make your life miserable. You can do it simply with one statement, split it, filter it, and then put the expression. You get the same result. That is why comprehensions have become so popular. People are using less and less of map and filter in Python. But if you ask a functional programming guy, he will always prefer this. The reason is, remember, it comes from mathematics. Here, what are we doing? We are combining two things in one. We are combining this filtering business as well as this transformation business. Both are combined in one expression, which is not really good for functional programming. In functional programming, you want to do very small things, just like in Unix commands. You have sort, unique, every command does something specific. So that is the same principle here.
Does the time complexity differ in both cases?
Yeah, it will differ. Comprehensions are fast, yeah.
So why would you prefer functional?
Yeah, so we'll not get into that, because that is a separate item. Functional programming has been around for a long time. As a concept, it started in the 1930s. But processing power was not available. But recently, functional programming is quite popular. And I believe that a lot of people will migrate to functional programming in the next 20 years. The main reason is concurrency. Functional programming enables you to reduce a lot of bugs in your program. It is much more powerful than object-oriented programming. But the future is, there will be a combination of object-oriented plus function, like scalar. That may be the future. So we will see new languages coming up, which will combine both object-oriented plus functional programming. So that is what people are predicting. So of course, performance-wise, it's different. See, the beauty of functional programming is, you can write an algorithm to verify your program. No business of testing. The algorithm can verify that the program is correct, because it comes from a mathematical background. See, mathematics is not just equations, right? You can prove x is equal to x. What is the problem with imperative programming like C? You say x is equal to x plus 1, yes? But if you give this, you write code right, like that, right? X is equal to x plus 1. But if a function programming guy sees that code, he will say this is crap. Because from a mathematical perspective, x is equal to x plus 1 has no solution. You cannot solve that equation. So assignments are not allowed in function programming, at least in pure function programming.
But one comment to this question, this comment. Actually, nowadays, anyway, CPUs are increasing fast, and all these kind of things are not a big issue. Even if it times, it takes extra time. What I'm telling is, suppose if you don't use this concept, assume that it takes 1 minute. If you use this concept, assume that it's gone to 2 minutes. So that 1 minute gap already it will be compensated with the increase in the CPU speed and the OS for customization or the cache customization or something else. So that will be compensated automatically. Because you compare the same program, if you had run some 20 years back, how was the performance, how now, what is the performance?
The point is that you have to
But I'll give one short answer since it is looks like an interesting discussion. The answer is, the main shortage today is developers. It is not CPU or memory. Right? That may be there in the background. The shortage today is developers, testers. So functional programming will help you to get your product out faster. Okay. So now another example here, map function. This returns a list of bools. Right? Simple. Here we are identifying all those words which are greater than 2 characters. Now, since you have a list of bools, can you combine this with the original list and give you a list of words which are greater than 2 characters? You got my statement. You have a list of bools which follow a certain predicate, in this case, length greater than 2. Can you combine these bools with the original list and give you that list which meets the predicate of true? So that is done by another function in the standard library called compress. So you can compress these two lists and then you will get words which are greater than 2 characters. So in fact, you know, there are a lot of methods already available in the core libraries which are quite powerful. You don't even have to go to third-party libraries. So today we looked at compress, we looked at accumulate. So those are some of the things you can use. Now this is where functional programming gets interesting. So here L words, what is L words? Yeah, this is the list of words, right? So this is the list of words which are greater than 2 characters, long words. So now I take an iterator on this, right? Everyone with me? Then I calculate the length. What do you expect as the output? So basically I want to calculate the length of that list. But instead of calculating the length on the original list, I take an iterator and then calculate length. So it's a type error. You can calculate length on the original list, but you can't calculate length on the iterator. Iterator can help you move element to element on the list. So how do you solve this problem? So the reason for this is some lists are infinite, or let's say millions of items. So you cannot store all of them, right? You will only, so suppose the list is coming from a generator expression. You will generate the item one at a time. This is what we call in Python lazy evaluation. You will not make the list upfront. You will make the list only when it's required, when the element is required. So the concept is you can do it through generator expressions. The general concept is called lazy evaluation. So now if you have lazy evaluation, all you have is an iterator. With iterator, you cannot find the length. How do you solve this problem? So this can be done with a library from tools. So this will help you to count. Even though the list is done lazily, evaluated lazily, using the iterator, you can call this function called count, and it will tell you how many items you will get from that list. Okay. But now, if I do this, what do you expect? Now I do next. See, the iterator has already reached the end of the list. That means iterator has been modified, which means that although this function is coming from this library, I will not call this function functional. It is not according to the construct of functional programming, because it modifies the input. Actually, its main output is the count, right? But it modifies the input as well, which means that the state of the program has been changed. So you have to be clear that some of the things in third-party libraries, they enable functional programming, but they may not be pure functional in the sense we understand. So how much time you have? 10 minutes? 5 minutes? So here I have a simple function called stem. So what it does is it simply removes the punctuation and stuff like that. So idea is to preserve only the words. That is the idea. So and then I have a sentence, this cat jumped over this other cat. Okay. Now the problem statement is I want to count the frequency of words occurring. And I want to ignore case and all that. So I have, this is a typical way you would write a program. You take a dictionary, you split this by the spaces, and for each word you apply this function called stem. Right? And then having applied this function, you add it to the dictionary. I mean add the count to the dictionary. So finally you will end up with the dictionary D, which will give you the count. So this is the frequency of words occurring in that string. Okay, everyone with me? So this is not a bad program. In fact, if you look at Python, this is a good program. This is the way people will normally write it. Easy to understand, it's efficient, stuff like that. But if you give it to a functional programming guy, he will say that this is too complex, right? Because you are doing too many things in that single loop. Because you are splitting it and then you are applying the stem function and then you are trying to do counting on the words. So you are trying to do too many things in one loop. So what the functional programming guy will do is, he will do something called composability. I will break all these things into three different functions and I will compose them into one behavior. So that is composability. So for example, mathematically this is how it is written. F, G, H of X, of two arguments, X, Y. If you do composability of these three functions, what it means is first you call H. Whatever H returns, you pass it to G. Whatever G returns, you pass it to H, the next function, which is F. So this is called composability. It's one of the fundamental concepts in functional programming. So now it turns out that this library tools can help you do this. So there are functions already to do compose, frequency, partial. Partial is similar to our partial functions. I think it's not used here, so I can actually remove this. And then I do some carrying also, right? If you don't understand, it's okay, you can take it offline. So now you see how I compose the same behavior in functional programming. I use this function called compose, frequencies, map, up stem, and then string split. So first split will run. Whatever it returns, it will go to stem. Whatever stem returns, it will go to frequencies. And this is obviously another function. So you call that function with syntax. You will get the same result. So this is composability implemented in functional programming. So you see how neat it is, because everything is abstracted. Now it's easy for you to change the program, which is very hard here. You can't change the program easily unless you understand all the parts. So one nice quote is, object-oriented programming has encapsulates all the moving parts. Okay? But functional programming reduces the number of moving parts. So it's easier to debug, easier to design, easier to program. And similar things can be done by other libraries. You will have this code, so I will not go through this. Group by. So this is from standard library. This is from third party library, ITEP groups, group by. And another thing about functional programming is pipelining. This is very related to composability. In composability, you are composing as a series of function calls, right? It's the way you write it mathematically. But another equivalent concept is pipelining, which people from the world of Unix will understand. You take your data, put it through a pipe. So first it goes through one pipe called F, which does some processing. Output goes to another pipe, G. Output goes to another pipe, H. Got it? So you may say it is equivalent to composability. It is. So it depends, you know, languages may implement either of those or both of those, it doesn't matter. But both of them enable functional programming. So this tools library, it's got this pipe. So this is your input, this is the data. So first you send it through split, then the stem function, and then finally frequencies. So you will get the same result. With me? Now interleaving. So we are at the end, just two more examples. Interleaving. So let's say you have three lists. So a list of first name, surname, and then maybe age or something like that. So if you want to interleave all of them, when I say interleaving, I want Praveen, so like this, Praveen Kumar 36, Hemant Venkat 43. So like that, I want a single list. That is called interleaving. So how do I do it? So you can do it in basic Python. You take a list and then you do this, combine dot extend. So then zip this. So you will get your output. So this is what we wanted, right? So those who understand, those who are beginners, you may find this a little cryptic. The reason is, what is the output of this list comprehension? Anybody can tell? Where is that output going?
To a combined list.
Yeah. So actually the output is not visible, so let me remove this. This is the output of the list comprehension, right? Because the input has four elements, output also has four. Because what does combine.extend return? Mm-hmm. It returns none. So you will get only this. But actually this is not what we want. What we want is combined, right? So that is why we are saving everything in combined. But if you give this to a functional guy, he will say this is not solving my problem. Because you are using something that is external and you are returning some nonsense which is not useful. You are keeping the state outside and changing that state. So functional programming guy will not be happy with this example. So he will try to use it in a functional way. It turns out that Python library itself supports it. So there is a library part, there is one called chain. So you simply use this chain from iterable. So no extra state business is involved. So you will get the same result. So I would say this is more functional in terms of functional programming than doing it the other way, the alternative that you saw earlier. And there's also a third party library for interleaving. So you can use either the core library or this one. Of course, I may prefer this because more programmers will understand, right? Because they are used to the core libraries. By the way, these tools, there is also something called C-Tools from the same author. So C-Tools is more, it's faster because it's implemented completely in C. Then, another example, last example, I guess. So you have a list of words. I want unique words. So there is in this package, there's something called unique. So this way you can easily generate a unique list of words. But suppose you want to ignore the hook case, then you can do it like this. Mind you, it is preserving the case of the original input, but when doing the comparison, it is ignoring the case. So potentially, this comparison could be any function. So what it indicates, firstly, this is functional. Secondly, this unique is a higher order function because it takes another function as an argument. So what did we learn? We learned first class functions, higher order functions, no side effects. That means, as somebody said, it should be a pure function. It doesn't depend on anything outside the context of the function. So that means not side effects. Side effects also means things like writing to a file. That is also a side effect. So in pure functional language, you are not supposed to do that. So it's important that if you are writing in functional programming languages, you have to know which parts of your program are functional. You will not get 100% functional. Somewhere you have to write to a file, write to a database, right? So it will not be 100% pure, but it's important for testers, for developers to know which parts are pure, which parts are impure, so that testing can be focused only on the impure parts. Now, what about the pure parts? It's very interesting. If you want to do debugging, you find a problem and you want to do debugging. In functional programming, debugging is very simple because all you need to do is look at the stack. Remember, there are no side effects. Input cannot come from any other way. You can do entire debugging by looking at the stack. No side effects, immutability of data, because no assignments, no states, so data is immutable. Lazy evaluation, partial functions. With relation to this, we also looked at closures, pipelining, querying, composability, and some of the examples we saw from these libraries. So So for more information, you can look up this page, Devopedia Functional Programming, which I just opened it here. So this gives an overview of functional programming. Those of you who are interested, you know, this is the history of functional programming and some discussion for you to understand what it is all about. So with this, we'll conclude.